tuning in to the online broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads from over 200 countries and your number one source in after-show entertainment. AfterBuzz TV, the destination for TV superfans. Producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows. Interviewing celebrities and showrunners. And bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Woo! Hello, AfterBuzzers. We're here during another AfterBuzz TV After Show for MTV's Teen Wolf Season 4, Episode 9, Perishable. I'm your host, Kristen Elizabeth Snyder. Joining me, AfterBuzz TV host June Lee.
Hey, everyone. Hey,
our special guest plays Dr. Brunski. Mm-hmm. Please welcome Aaron Hendry.
Woo! Hey, everybody. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for coming back.
Seriously.
You bet.
You
psyched to be back.
Fantastic last night. Mm. You're so scary.
It's a good episode.
For those of you who don't know, Aaron actually played the new Gitsune.
Yeah, last season.
And he was so good, they ended up making him the main villain last season and also writing Dr. Brunski for his character.
Yeah, I know.
Which
you're kind of badass.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Well, they're badass. I mean, they really, I just, honestly, I can't ever sing the praises on Jeff Davis enough.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he's, you know, June and I were talking about this before the show. He responds to what he sees happening in the show and happening on set. He's got a game plan. He's playing it out ahead of himself, but he does. He watches the performances. He watches the rehearsals. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and if something's working, he keeps writing it, you know. And this little thing that came up in the original Eichenhouse episode, turned into a new guy.
Yeah.
And we got some good scary out of him, so it was fun. Yeah.
That is so exciting. Yeah. I'm glad that they brought you back because you just have like all the characteristics of an amazing villain.
Yeah, I know. I was like, oh my gosh, he's a villain again.
Yeah.
But I felt like it was a little different because like what do you think he was like in love with Meredith?
I don't think so.
I sense
you
like some
that?
Sort of like sadness.
There's some,
and like there was like a tear.
There's some awesome stuff that's gonna come up.
That's gonna come up.
Yeah. He's only a different kind of sicko. Mm-hmm. Like there's a sadism to him, but yeah, there's something. You're right. That there's something off with him about his relationship with his patients.
And yeah.
He feels. You know, that there's something in it that for him isn't cruel. It's their therapy. There's some sick stuff going on there.
I really hope that we get to explore that because we just got a moment of it, which we'll talk about more later.
Mm-hmm.
But he said a lot of stuff that I'm like, that's exactly what someone who's doing bad, like they reason to make it good, you know? And that happens a lot in this world. It's like villains, they don't actually think what they're doing is bad. They think they're doing good
there's
for the world.
Right. And those are
justification.
And those are the scariest villains,
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nando in the booth. I feel like some people are on the iChat sending us messages. So if you see anything you want to read to us, let us know. But I hear people.
Yeah.
I hear the chat. So maybe if we can turn off the little bing.
Oh my gosh.
But you guys can feel free to call in. The number is 424-256-1729. Join the discussion. Tweet June. She has her Twitter up at
Miss MS_June Lee.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Let's go ahead and start breaking down the episode.
Let's do it.
All right. So we get Parrish is in trouble.
Oh my goodness.
Dude, I love Parrish in this episode.
I love it.
He was like the Terminator.
Totally. It was so awesome.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I've only gotten to work with Ryan a few times, but I like him. He's a really fun guy to be on set with and, you know, and they've been working on that character this season. Like, you notice him. Like, anytime you see the characters, like, starting to have more solid friendships, you know, that they're finding something for that character.
Right,
yeah.
Totally.
It's like they did with you. They saw, you know, that he could really act, and they developed and wrote that character.
Great. And he, like you said, he just looks like such a badass in this episode.
That was, they did him justice.
Oh my God,
they did him justice.
You know?
It was like a whole nother Parrish, like a whole other side of him.
Well, I like that because that's, you know, he's gonna be some sort of supernatural creature now. So let's go ahead and talk about it. His teammate, cop, turned on him.
Yeah.
Hey.
Totally.
I can't believe that. You know, you work with these guys for how long? You think they'd be on your side, and they're the ones, you know, trying to, I guess, make money off
money,
his dad.
I know.
Yeah.
Totally. And that, I loved that change in this episode. You know, comes up later on. Mm-hmm. We'll get to it, but where they start talking about how available is this list now?
And then there's that terrifying scene. And then it's coming out of everyone's printer.
Appearing all over. And I love that opening scene suddenly set the table for anyone can turn on you.
Yes.
Anyone. Mm-hmm. You start talking about this kind of danger and this kind of money, you know, with friends like that, who needs enemies, as they say. You know, anyone can turn on you.
Yeah.
I think that opening scene is terrifying.
I know.
Because we don't know anything about.
And that scream.
Oh my God.
It was like haunting. Like,
yes. I mean, like, definitely, I was buying. Oh, he's in pain. He's gone.
I thought he was a goner.
You know?
Yeah.
So it seems like his character does die and then rises from the ashes. Yeah. And people on the web are predicting that he's a phoenix because that's sort of what a phoenix does.
Yes. Right. Somebody also on the MTV website, which is where we watch the episode sometimes, Loya Mutt said, and I hope I'm saying that right, Loya Mutt said that he might be a dragon because in other shows, dragons have taken the human form. Do they take the human form on Game of Thrones?
I didn't know that they took the human form.
Yeah,
I didn't know
I
dragons
never heard
did
of that.
That
either, but supposedly it happens. I thought that was really interesting.
That
I think
is.
It's a phoenix, though.
I think you're right. Yeah. It's interesting that people are seeing it as different things, but I'm excited to see. Is that his only power? Can he survive just fire? Can he survive other things?
Yeah,
does
Jeff
he have
was talking about
other
that.
Powers of the phoenix? Can he fly? Is he, are we going to be
I
discovering
know.
These things with him? Is he going to fall off a building and suddenly find his wings?
But he seemed a little Supermanish when he was walking.
I totally thought the same thing. I was like, dude, Ryan's the next Superman. Look at him.
Like, he was like this boyish, handsome, sweet.
I just really like actor to actor. I was so impressed with him in this episode because that opening scene is terrifying. Like you definitely get terror, mortal terror for my life, you know. And then like he pulls this like vengeful tough guy stuff. But what I like is the Clark Kent thing of even where he's talking to Derek and the rest of the team, he's so innocent about it. He's still just this small town guy, you know.
Right,
and I love that. I think it's a lot
like,
of range.
I'm only worth $5. Come on. Like,
$5 million.
And it's like, wait a second. I don't even make like $40,000 a year.
I love that.
Yeah, he kept repeating that. He repeated that last week. He repeated this week.
Yeah. That's another thing I like about this episode.
Yeah.
I do. Like, and we can talk about that later too, but the stuff that comes up about the Stilinski hospitalization.
Yeah.
Yes, let's go ahead and talk about that.
Yeah, let's just talk about that now.
Because Stiles says, you know, he's going through all his dad's stuff because he wants to take care of his dad. And his dad's like, I'm supposed to take care of you. I'm the father.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Stiles was like, well, we should be taking care of each other.
How heartbreaking is that?
It was. And that makes me think when Scott goes back underneath his bed and counts that money.
Yeah.
Right.
Was it not all there?
Yeah, I know. That's what I was thinking.
And the
too.
Zipper was sort of open, right?
That's going to come up again, so I can't tell you anything about that. But what I like
We're
about it
all this
is.
Month.
Yeah, no, I'm too, the guy's so good. Wait till you see the next two episodes. He's going to get you so sure so many things are happening and then blow your mind again. Like, he's so good at it. But the thing I like about it is, there's a way in which, in this episode, you know, it comes up about paying the hospital bills. It comes up about his dad's mortality. The two cops arguing about how, you know, their cops risk their lives and their salaries are a joke. Like, cops and teachers just get paid garbage. And these are the foundations of our culture. And so I love that he doesn't hit us over the head, but he brings in like stuff that the modern teenager is worried about. Like, they hear their parents arguing about, can we afford to send the kid to college? They hear their parents like worried about the health insurance crisis. And I love that he's not afraid to put that stuff in the show.
Absolutely.
You know?
Without beating you over the head with
totally.
That. He's so tactful about putting these types of details in there. It's really.
Well, it makes them seem like real teenagers with real families,
right,
you know?
Right.
I think this season took on a whole different element. You know, it is a supernatural show, but it's nice that anyone can be a killer.
Totally.
Especially if they need the money. That's sort of taking on the whole Breaking Bad thing. I mean, we all have our own problems, and then if the money comes up, even with Stiles, it seems like he's having this little internal debate with whether he should take some of that money from the bag under Scott's bed, whether he did or not. I'm not sure yet. But it seems like he's even struggling. And he's normally a good guy.
And you get it. You totally understand. And it's like, hello? Okay, this cop was shot while at work. Can we not take care of his hospital bills?
There's going to be some stuff that's not paid for by your insurance.
Are you kidding me?
I hope that doesn't really happen.
I don't know either. I mean, the department covers you in the line of duty, but
they
it would
better.
Be like, unfortunate. But that's the whole point. Like,
I know.
You wouldn't be surprised to read that in the news today.
Yeah.
You wouldn't
be
surprised to read some story about cop who gets run over in the line of duty and, like, his pension won't cover it or whatever, you know? And it's just, you know, so I love that. I love that element that, you know, it comes up when the coach is, like, wagging his finger at him about partying before the game. Like, I love that he does just enough to stay with these are the lives of high school students.
Yeah.
And
right.
they have, beyond the problems they have, they're the supernatural stuff.
Right,
they
right.
have the lives of a high school student's problem,
exactly.
you know? Like, it's cool.
It is. Yeah. So we have a caller on the line.
Yay.
Caller, what's your name? Where are you from?
Hey guys, it's Johan. How's it going, guys?
Johan, how are you? Thank you for calling in. Do you have a question for Aaron?
Yeah, I actually have a question for everybody.
Oh, okay.
What's up, man?
Even though the brilliant mind of Jeff Davis said before that no one that has been killed in the past would come back.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a small possibility that Allison can come back somehow?
Well,
maybe. I'm just asking.
Look, it's a question that only, you know, Jeff and his creative team can really answer. But you know what's. What's cool,
I'm
what I think
asking.
Is cool about
I'm
it, well, you know, what I think is cool about it, and it's a good question, but what I think is cool about the show is, we were talking about this last year when Allison was killed, like, they're not afraid to kill people, and so it gives you a sense of the danger being real, and if the show resurrects everybody, all their good guys all the time, then you're like, whatever, he's not
no
really
stakes.
Dead.
Exactly.
I mean, anything's possible. I don't know. I mean, what do you think? What do you think the odds of getting one of our heroes back is?
You know what? From what it had said on the internet, Allison wanted to move on and do other things. Yeah. I know we all want her back.
Mm-hmm. And we all wish Crystal Reed the best.
Yeah, definitely. You know, sometimes for one reason or another, this is a dark show. You know, maybe she needed to work on something lighter for herself.
Totally.
We don't really know her reasons, but we gotta respect them. I don't think they're gonna bring her back just because of especially her wishes are to continue on as an actress to other projects. But you know what? I'm there from the beginning. Everyone loved the Scott and Allison from the beginning. We all still admire that kind of first love relationship represented on screen.
Mm-hmm.
So I know we're all having a hard time getting over it.
Yeah,
but thank you.
I mean, it is Teen Wolf, I guess.
It is Teen Wolf.
Anything can happen on
Teen
Wolf.
Anything can happen.
It's true.
Well, thank you so much for calling in. I really appreciate your question, and thanks for your support.
Take it easy, John. Thanks.
You're welcome, guys. Have a great night.
You too. Bye. So Liam, he's upset because he's now worth $18 million instead of $3 million. And the other thing is Derek's not on the list anymore. So does that mean that he's now human?
Well, that's the thing, is that they were saying online that, everybody in the
interwebs.
Fandom, they're just so brilliant. Anna Mao One was saying that, it's like Derek kind of already died. Like that part, that Derek Hale that we knew is already gone. Like when Kate took him to the, you know, that ancient temple, like the Derek that was supernatural and that we knew was it's kind of gone. It's dead already. Yeah. So that would make sense. That would make sense.
Here's what I like about this thematically, though. And again, like, I'm always speaking as, like, you know, an actor reading scripts. This is what I like about this thematically for the show. It gives room for Scott to become the alpha of the
right.
show, which
mm-hmm.
is, I think, a big thing in this
Absolutely.
Season.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like the Scott of this season is, like, is the mentor of the season. He's a huge step up in being in
mm-hmm.
command. You know,
mm-hmm.
he is the one making decisions and taking actions, and like, he's the man of the house now.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I don't think that means we have to lose Derek. I think that
no.
that it's, you know, you look at all these, like, Joseph Campbell, like archetypical journeys, like mm-hmm. there's a whole new thing that can be done with the Derek character
yeah.
in terms of exploring his future and exploring, right. you know, Derek is such a paladin, such a cavalier in certain
mm-hmm,
ways, and
mm-hmm.
and to explore that as just a man, you know, the
right.
the good he can do in the world, you
he,
know.
Him
that,
and Brayden should just go and make babies.
Yeah.
Well, and make a family, a beautiful man. He would make such
yeah.
a great dad.
Now, would he still have werewolf babies? Like, is it only that
yeah.
he's no longer?
That's a good question.
He's human now, so.
Yeah. Well, you know what I think is important about this episode? It does look like Brayden taught him how to bend, like we were talking about last week. And
mm-hmm.
also, it's important that he realizes he can be a hero even with the loss of his powers.
Right.
Yes.
He's not sulking in, I can't help anyone because
right,
I'm not
right.
a werewolf anymore.
Yeah.
So the fact that you can find a hero within yourself,
mm-hmm.
Even after
yeah,
you
totally.
Have those supernatural qualities gone, I think is very important, and especially in this episode.
And I love that moment when Scott was like, oh, what happened to your gun? And Derek is like, hello, you're covered in gasoline, you're gonna catch on fire. Like, now he's using
nice.
His like brains,
yeah,
not only just, you know,
mm-hmm.
guns, but like human brains to kind of fight off evil. So I thought that was really cool.
Yeah, no, I enjoy that. So let's move on to the lacrosse Burning Man party, or
yeah.
just this
How
little
sweet is that?
This little bonfire. So it looks like, you know, Scott's trying to take care of everyone,
mm-hmm.
but Malia and Liam insist on getting drunk because they're both upset
mm-hmm.
about different things.
Right.
Malia is very upset about not the fact that Peter is her father, but
right.
more so the fact that Stiles kept it from
right.
her.
Right.
Because he obviously holds a high place in her life as
yeah.
someone she trusted.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that he kept that from her so long really affected her whole being. You know,
yeah.
he was the one person she felt she could really trust. And with him withholding that information, it's definitely setting back their
well,
relationship at
what
this
do
point.
You think, Kristen? Would you react the same way as a woman?
Mm-hmm.
You know, would you react the same way?
You know what? It's such a huge deal.
Mm.
If someone knew who my father was and I was going through all these difficult problems, it was obvious she was going to find out eventually. So I
mm.
would hope that those that I trusted the most would come to me
mm-hmm.
and give me the information that they knew and not withhold that sort of like deep, crucial human need to
right.
know where you come from information from me.
Mm.
I feel like he was sort of withholding it for selfish reasons because, you know, he didn't want her to go off and form another relationship with another man, even that being
so?
Even that relationship
wow.
being father daughter
mm.
he knew he would lose her, and at that point he was everything to a female. So
Aww.
You know
yeah.
that's how I feel about it.
Yeah.
I get it. I know that they're gonna fix things and she's gonna come around and he's gonna
mm-hmm.
you know apologize, but hopefully we'll get that in future episodes.
Well, I mean, listen, okay, I'm a you know, Stiles is my boy, so
I
just love Dylan. I was so psyched that I got to, my last episode got to be so
that
Dylan
awesome.
Heavy because I just like you know,
except
he's
for when
you punch
him in the face.
He's, except when I punch him in the face.
I know.
No, but I mean just as actors, like he is my bosom
yeah.
buddy on
yeah.
the set. He really is. I started out with him and it was fun to go the distance with him, and but so much Stiles defend a little here. Like
mm-hmm.
something I love mm-hmm. about the writing in the Malia character is one of the things we love about her is who knows what the hell she's gonna do. Like
right.
like she is a loose
yeah.
cannon.
Mm-hmm.
And so I do get how in that position as, you know, a teenager who loves her and has his own feelings mixed up, that part of the attraction to this girl is she's crazy. And, and you tell her something like this, who knows what she's going to haul off.
That's very valid. You did a fantastic job.
A guy's point of view.
I understand.
I'm so glad that we did this.
Anybody who's like been in the same relationship for over a year with a woman, like, you know, there's certain moments where you're like, if I say this, the unbelievable mayhem storm that is about to happen, and I know I'm supposed to, and I know I should, but the payoff of this is going to be so vicious, you know? Ooh. And you get that about Malia. And and again, I think as an audience, it's part of what we love about her is like, that chick's crazy. You know?
I love her. She is my new favorite character. Same. Someone who I know you stem from a past where you grew up in heavy woods, you know, in your backyard. You play it outside a lot. I did too. I admire her so much for just acting on her natural instincts, being this wild child. I love it. I think that it we all need it. I feel like as a culture we need it. So I'm glad when she sticks up for her natural instincts and they're represented in the show.
Well, and you know, again, like Shelley is just Shelley's awesome. You know, the first Eichenhouse episode, Shelley and I were in together. We had the first Brunski episode. He gets in this fist fight with her. And and she's just, like, talk about an actor who is fun on set, keeps her sense of humor, has that sort of like, whoa, what's going on? Like, cavalier, like, she's cool. She's she really is. She's someone who's just naturally cool. You want to hang out with her. But she's complimentary of the other actors. She's appreciative of the job. She's appreciative of the script. Like, she's a great actress to work with. So I'm psyched that that character is getting such a good response because I think she can have a long life on the show if she wants it, you know?
Yeah. No, I agree. And I'm curious if they're going to now make Parrish, you know, one of the main characters, too, if he's going to become part of the pack or what his fate is.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it's I mean,
I hope so.
it's really smart to me that they're like, you know, the original team is growing up, you know. And so with that, some of the storylines with their parents, with their, you know, all their associations, like, I think they're doing a very smart job of, like, building new friendships and new packs and new teams, you know, because it's, you know, like it's a
it's
high
like
school
life.
Show.
Yeah, it's like life,
these guys
you
are going
to
graduate high school eventually. And then, you know, you have to have some new stuff, some material for us to move on with.
Right,
know?
So they're doing a good job, like, laying the pipe for future episodes.
Absolutely.
But so then, you know, it turns out that the DJ, now is the DJ one of, like, the bad guys here?
Because
I mean, music in the show is amazing, and I love that it's now a villain. Yes. I liked that the music was involved as being a bad guy and was actually what was, you know, they have that, like, noise that only dogs can hear, and it affects them. So I think they were sort of going off that kind of frequencies that affects werewolves.
Yeah, I was wondering what that was.
Yeah.
Dude, but I love that. I think it's, again, it's just, like, such an original idea. And it's simple, and it works, and yet, like, it immediately places them in this disastrous scenario that that just instinctively we're all afraid of.
And it was brilliant because, like, they act intoxicated and then then it's like, and for the environment, the security guards come in like, oh yeah, they're too intoxicated. It's like, what a
like totally hopeless and at the mercy of the world, and the world has gone crazy around you. Like, it is, it's a scenario that anybody just instinctively responds to with panic, you know, which makes the scene such a payoff that, like, he pulls the big hero stuff. Scott does. But I agree, like, the way they kept shooting the DJ, like, like, it wasn't just the sound, like, they were fixated on that character in this really, like, vicious sort of way, and yet also was just the intensity of the party. So I thought that was an awesome fine line in this episode.
Totally,
you know.
Yeah, I agree. I could talk about that forever because
it's
just
a cool
like
scene.
The visual of like raves and the DJ's part in it all, and
it's a cool scene.
I loved it. So let's go ahead and talk about Lydia's grandmother because Lorraine. We were confused about whether they were, you know, showing us that she could be the benefactor considering. she wrote right. that code. And then we kind of get the backstory told by Lydia talking about, you know, how her grandmother was in love with this woman, Maddie, mm-hmm. and right. sort of predicted her death.
I love that it was a woman.
And then we finally yeah, find out what happened in the White Room. Mm-hmm. So that's where they brought in the psychologist and Meredith to help them figure out how it was possible that Lorraine actually mm-hmm. knew mm-hmm. that, you know, her partner was going to die. Mm-hmm. So I'm glad that we finally got what happened in that right. in that white room. And it makes sense because, you know, white rooms, the white padded rooms, it right. all makes sense that that's like a psychological
yes.
room where chaos happened. Mm-hmm. We were like debating what was going on in that room. I thought it might be something worse considering like it was a soundproof room.
Well, and I love, you know, I love the... Again, like the working every angle on the banshee connection between mm-hmm. Meredith and Lydia mm-hmm. and her grandmother, and the mm-hmm. way they keep you guessing, but the way they go to this like this horrible like now generational guilt of how they've ruined yeah. Meredith's life, you know yeah. how they've driven her crazy, like all this stuff, like it's just. You know, it leads you so in, and there's more to discover on that. There's more yeah. stuff that's gonna
so,
come up.
I hope so,
because
it was so
Lorraine.
Much information like, yeah. so Lorraine fast,
and then over. It just ended.
Yeah. yeah.
So I was like,
yeah. yeah. So then we find out that this is not who's going to die list that the Ariel cipher key reveals, but it's who already died, and it just so happens right. this that they were the 10 suicides that happened at Eichenhaus.
Well,
and Dr. Brunski
just happens to clean them all up.
Yeah, so
what are you gonna do?
Stiles and Lydia sets off to investigate. Mm-hmm. And
right, what a good idea that was.
Right. So they try to bribe you, and then you put in this mixtape, and I was like, oh my,
something is not right.
At that point, mm-hmm. we obviously were all pointing the finger at you because mm-hmm. the other mixtapes all had instructions on them, but this one, of course, had music that you were right. listening to.
Yeah, right.
yeah, a lot's gonna. We had a really interesting discussion. Jennifer Lynch, who is the director of this episode, have she ever had her on?
We haven't.
She's
no,
amazing. She's amazing. We had a really. There's a line that comes up right before he attacks them, where he says, "It was the tapes, wasn't it?"
Yeah. And, what did that mean?
Well, because we had this discussion of. When has he decided he's going to do the man?
Right.
Which
mm-hmm.
then basically goes to when has Meredith decided she's going to do the man? And realizing that in this episode, this for Meredith and Brunski and like the sick thing that's going on between them that you don't know about until now, this moment's an improvisation. Like they did not plan on doing these kids in right now. This is mm-hmm. this is a surprise to them that has to get handled.
Right.
That this isn't a trap. That he laid for them, that he was legitimately going to try to get rid of them, but they cross the line of knowing too much.
Right.
And,
right.
and
I thought that was a great yeah. line, because that's what it meant to me, is, okay, because you guys noticed the tapes, because they yeah. did. They glanced back and forth
yes.
at each other. It
yes.
definitely stuck out in both their minds that something was off, and they were new about the tapes.
Mm-hmm.
So they were definitely already pointing the finger at you mentally, and so were we.
Yeah, yeah. So is Brunski saying that to Meredith?
He says that to Lydia.
Yeah.
Okay.
When they're looking
okay.
over
yeah.
the list.
Yeah.
And then the other one that I think in which I loved that they wrote in, it just cracked me and O'Brien up so freaking much was when he's taking the injection and he says, you know, I don't have any special powers. But somehow I just knew we were going to get to do this again. and I loved that because it was a nice
was
throwback
a
line that
yeah,
it started
totally.
With that character.
Yeah.
But also indicates that he didn't see this, that this is a happy surprise for him.
Mm-hmm.
That getting to kill these two kids wasn't in his plan, but why not? They're here
yeah.
and I'll have fun.
What's
you know?
So wrong with him?
And was he planning on just drugging them? Or was that just the beginning of it?
Of an overdose?
Because was the overdose going to be how they died? Because there was that line about, you know, teenagers breaking into the drug closet.
Yeah.
So was that the plan, was just going to be an overdose? Or I was like, is this the beginning of the torture?
I think, you know, the way I read it you know, it's a good question. We'll never get the answer to that question. The way I read it, he's up against the wall mm-hmm. with what these kids have discovered,
right.
and he's got to OD them, and then somehow, you know, the same way he's done with the others, set up a suicide, or set up that they OD'd accidentally, okay. that they broke in, something
so
like that.
So it was supposed to be an OD.
Yeah, okay.
That's what I thought too.
Yeah, I think he's making up the cover up on that as he's going mm-hmm. along. You know.
Now, I want to talk about what he thinks about helping these patients who weren't helped. He saw that he didn't think that could be helped. He thought that by helping them commit suicide, it was a release for them. And he talks a little bit about it. Can you explain more of that to us and sort of what was going on in the character's mind?
Sure. Well, you know, I'll tell you what I think. And this is... You know, this is part of the fun of being an actor is you create, you know, we talked about this with the Nogitsune, with a lot mm-hmm. of the physical stuff. You create stuff that, you know, the audience is never going to say, oh, that's what he's doing. But what it does then is it creates behavior, because the part in the scene that I actually love the most is when he gets mad that they call him a serial killer.
Yeah. Yeah.
That he's resentful, that's the mm-hmm. way they're going to think about him, because obviously he thinks he's doing something of much greater importance
right.
than that.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, stuff's going to come out about, you know, yeah. you add up the years. Meredith couldn't have been alive while he was doing all of this,
right.
you know, or at least could not have been as influential as this. So stuff's going to come out about that. But there's, you know, there's a lot of,
excited.
It's so fun. It's good. You're going to dig it.
Yeah.
There's a lot of stuff. I mean, put it in a really simple analogy, and they talk about using the Jedi mind trick on the weak mind, you know,
mm.
and I don't think that Brunski's weak-minded, but it's clearly someone who has a fracture in his mind about morality,
right.
about right and wrong, that I definitely, you know, when I got that script, started doing some research about schizophrenic people who literally hear voices.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I think he did, but I thought, what an interesting connection with the Banshee and with a character who
right.
something... He
right.
feels, he says she was controlling me.
Yeah.
He obviously for some time has felt like there is another consciousness that compels
right.
me to
yeah.
do this
right.
stuff.
Wow, that is so fascinating.
Yeah,
so do
you know.
we will get to see more of the Brunski-Meredith kind of relationship?
You'll get to discover
to.
More about,
okay.
about
yeah.
the way that was operating.
I'm super curious
yeah.
as to yeah. where
I,
that's going.
And
it's,
yeah,
it's
I
gonna,
hope there's
it's,
some
it's,
flashbacks.
It's bigger.
Something, yeah.
It's
right.
bigger. It's you'll get to discover some stuff about
okay.
that.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know.
But I just think it's so important to meditate on that moment for a second, that just, you know, villains, they all do
yeah.
have this mindset. They are doing something positive for the person who they're torturing and also the world.
Yeah.
So, like, saying that he was helping them reach that release, I mean, it's very kind of like an emotional thing, but also it's kind of cool psychologically to think about mm-hmm. what that means exactly, because, you know, internally I'm sure they are all fighting some sort of very serious psychological disease, and then saying that he's helping them reach that kind of release of maybe whatever those internal voices are that they are hearing.
Mm-hmm. Well, there was an interesting thing like a year ago now, the first Brunski episode last season, that Jeff said about it when, you know, because I shot both characters in that episode. If you remember, I played
yeah.
both characters
uh-huh.
in Icon House. So playing Brunski was actually literally a 12-hour surprise to me. Like, I got the script, and the next day I was playing this character. And so
crazy.
He, thank God, he came to the set that day and let me ask him some questions. And, you know, he told me a story about someone he knew. And, you know, I'm going to do my best not to reveal too much, because it was a personal story, but he talked about having some personal knowledge of these guys who work with mentally disturbed teenagers in particular, that you have these kids in like the physical prime of their life, jacked up on all sorts of hormones and medications and with serious problems, and that people who work with them are constantly dealing with, I'm trying to help you and you do anything you can to hurt me. Like the second I turn my back, you're looking to stab a pen in my neck.
Oh.
And he said, you gotta get
it
that
gets to
this,
you.
Yes, that this guy's been been through so many years of this that it is warfare between him and these kids.
Right,
and
right.
And that's not what he set out for, but but what he set out to do was help them. And right. that seed of it really was helpful for me and the character in saying that everything he's doing somehow for him is an effort to keep some order and some sanity around here in a frickin' jungle that he has to deal with. You know what I mean? So so like, I got carried that all the way to the end.
I'm so glad you shared that, because that really reveals like a lot of backstory for that character. And that's very helpful in understanding exactly,
you know,
the villain in this
as
episode.
An actor, without a doubt, you know,
definitely.
Gives you something to build on.
Because
you you wonder how people like this end up this way.
Yeah,
you know, what
exactly.
happened to this guy, you know?
I think that, you know, that's a huge part of his character, and I kind of wish we got to hear that monologue from him, you know? I think it's very helpful.
That's true.
It's,
that would have made a great monologue.
Like, to understand the inside working of a villain.
Yeah.
So,
he was making tapes.
Yeah. Oh, that's awesome. I'm looking forward to those tapes. So let's talk a little bit about Meredith. And is she trying... Now, it's appearing that she is the benefactor here. And, you know, could she possibly have done this all alone? Is she trying to get revenge?
And where is she getting the money?
I know.
Yeah, did she steal the money from the vault? I don't think she was
Malia's
the one.
Is she Malia's mother? I don't think she's old enough to be Malia's mother.
No,
I don't think that's anything to do with it.
Yeah.
But the thing is, she's been in Eichenhaus, and she's controlling people. So I don't think she was the one who stole the money, because she was in Eichenhaus. Mm. I think she's definitely working with somebody else, and maybe she's controlling them. I want to know exactly how she was controlling you, and is that something Lydia can do?
But she was the benefactor. She is the benefactor, right?
Well,
I feel like there's more than one benefactor.
Yeah, I agree. I think there might be partners.
Like I said, and you're going to discover more, but like the interesting thing that comes up for me in the sort of folklore of this episode, what I was talking about with the banshees and the schizophrenia, and actually even goes back to all the void possession, is this idea of we have this group of people, the banshees, that hear voices, and you know, and now you have this one that obviously has made someone else act out on their will. And so it brings up the question, that one of the questions that's going to come up a lot is who these people's identity are, if there's something going on inside them that they feel is other, but now starts compelling them to do something.
Wow.
So who is it doing these things? Because Brunski's just the first one to put it on the nose of saying, you think it was me, and it was him. He killed all these people, and he says, but it wasn't me. I'm not acting on my behalf.
Mm-hmm.
So then you have to ask that about all these characters acting on their own behalf.
Maybe
like,
Meredith's
how far gone
on her
is
own
she?
Behalf. Yeah.
Into someone else's devices, you know?
Right. Yeah. No, you know what? I don't think I never pinpointed her as being the benefactor, because she just came off as someone who really was sick but had these powers but couldn't quite get a handle on them, and was just sort of, she has kind of always seemed like an instrument, you know?
Do you remember her very first scene?
With the phone?
Year. Yes. Do you remember what she says on the phone?
There's one behind me.
She's
right.
Yes, and who is it that's behind her?
Stiles.
And
he was.
And Malia.
Malia. Mm-hmm. So she's talking to nobody on the phone, and she's talking about, she's right behind me.
Yeah.
And so, to me, and I don't know, this is just me watching the episodes. To me, it makes me go like this. There's some multiplicity thing that's been going on this girl for a long while, where she's been having conversations about these people on the list for a long time. And you see what I'm saying?
Oh, I see. She's talking about the people who are on the list.
Well, because there's no payoff in the last season of what that phone call is about.
Right.
But Stiles isn't. But is that why his name is on the list now?
Well, it gets written in at the very last second. You know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, who wrote it in? It wasn't Lydia. I don't know that it could have been Dr. Brunske.
But you remember, he says it's in your handwriting.
He tells Lydia.
Which then brings up, so did she write it in? And if when she wrote, and she says, I don't remember doing it.
Oh
So it's all this stuff of when you do things, are you not acting as yourself?
Oh,
and
my
how many people going on in this plot are not are acting as someone else, even though it's them doing it?
Yeah. Remember, I think it was the beginning of this season when I was like, I feel like Lydia's going crazy a little bit. Do you remember?
I do.
And
good job.
And then we were like, the possession thing has already happened with Stiles. Mm-hmm. But now I'm rethinking, like, yeah, I think that's a possibility.
That's like a very interesting thing, is, you know, that there's something going on, that you're doing actions for somebody else. And it's sort of like the whole puppeteering of the strings, you know, like, who are they pulling on? And that's such a scary thing.
Mm-hmm. Well, and again, I love it thematically for a show that's a teenage show and a show that's about shape-shifting. Because what it does for me is it says, this show, like these wonderful, amazing events that are happening in this show, what it hits home about is how many times, especially when we were teenagers, but even as adults, do you have moments where you literally say, I can't believe that was me.
Yeah.
I can't believe I did that. I felt like someone else.
Yeah. Totally.
And that's what it hits in us, is we all have moments gripped by rage or love or whatnot that we look back and it's as if someone has to tell us it was us, you know? And I remember this fist fight I got in when this guy hit one of my brothers. Mm-hmm. My brother got in this argument in this parking lot, but my brother was walking away from the argument. When he turned his head, this guy reached out and punched my brother.
Oh, that's so shady.
Literally the next thing I knew, I was standing on the sidewalk and the guy was lying in the street with a bloody nose and a fat lip. And I had to turn to my brother and go, I just beat him up. And he said, yeah, you did.
Wow.
And
you
I had
remember?
No idea.
Oh, wow.
I had to like replay it in my head and realize I'd done it. And it was literally like, I knew I'd done it, but like it was someone other than me that did it.
It was like Catherine Zeta-Jones of Chicago.
Yeah.
She didn't realize she did it.
Yes.
And she was driving the butt off.
And I love that dramatically, because I think ultimately it plays on that in us, that we all have those moments of, it doesn't feel like me, and yet I know it's me. You know what I mean?
That's really cool. We're bringing up so many very enlightened psychological issues. Like,
I know.
Well, that's what I love
Aaron
about this
so
show.
Smart.
It's a deep show,
It is a deep show. It is, and I'm glad that we have this after show that we can talk about it. Well, before we head out, I want to ask you a few questions about what you're working on and your time on Teen Wolf. So can you remind us all, we've talked to you about it before, what sort of, maybe from your childhood or from when you were younger, what led you into wanting to be an actor and then maybe like your first break?
You know, I grew up in the sticks, you know, and it's, being an actor was one of those things that I don't know when I decided that's what I was going to do. I just knew it's what I was going to do. Like by the time I was a teenager, there wasn't anything else I was going to do. And I got lucky to do a lot of live theater and a lot of traveling shows. I went overseas with my brother for a little while doing street shows.
What kind of street shows?
Yeah. We did puppet shows and stilt walking shows.
Wow.
We did this trick sword fighting show where we had we made these puppets where we would use a child's set of clothing, and the head of the puppet was on our elbow. So there's another small person standing right here, and this is his hand. So I'm two people. I'm me, and I'm this guy.
It's kind of like ventriloquism.
More focused on the movement of it. And so we would do these shows where we were each these, like, spadaccino is the Italian word for it, these swashbuckling sword fighters, but we were ourself and our sidekick. So we'd fight each other, and then our sidekicks would fight each other, and then we'd argue with our sidekick, and it was just like goofiness.
That is hilarious. I would love to see something like that.
It was fun.
Yeah.
I'll text you a picture.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, please.
And, tweet it out, too.
Everybody can see it.
I have red hair down to here. I have this crazy, Sons of Anarchy mustache going on.
Was it real?
That was me in my 20s, you know?
Even the hair?
Yep.
But
what I mean is, like, I got fortunate enough to live a whole life of a wide range of live performance before I ever got to TV. Yeah. And it made it hard because I got to TV actually through, I got to film finally through the Polar Express. I was doing a trick show, I was doing a circus show, and I got hired to do a bunch of the mocap work. I was with a small circus called the Eye of Newt Circus, and they had seen a number of circuses and hired a handful of circus performers to do a lot of the motion capture work. And so that was the first time I was making camera money for several months straight. And so that was in my early 30s, and I got an agency, and they said, look, it's going to be an uphill battle because you've been doing live work, which is great. But the thing that was always the strong suit was I'd learned to do my job well.
And it shows.
Thank you. It does.
Thanks,
it
really does. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Like all the movements that you did as the new gets in it, it's all making sense, especially you doing these street acts.
Exactly.
Now, did you have to take, did they make you take acting classes or anything?
I have taken a lot of acting classes. Whenever I'm not working, I still do.
Wow.
I think it's very, very important. I think as an actor, you have to never decide that you are done, never decide that you are good enough. But right now, fortunately, for a couple of years, I've been busy.
Can we talk about some stuff that you're working on?
Sure. I was working on Major Crimes for a while. I was working on Franklin and Bash for a while. So I had some good little guest stars on the hiatus for Teen Wolf. Came back and did, you know, a handful for Teen Wolf. There's a Disney pilot on the table right now.
It's
testing this week. And I've been in many times, sort of they're kind of looking for a spot maybe for me on the new 12 Monkeys that shoots up in Vancouver. And I don't know if I'm allowed to say this, but I get to read for a new show tomorrow that I think that it's in the trades. I get to read for a show that Patrick Stewart's gonna be on.
And
Professor X. So like
that's a huge
thing for me, you know. And so
Send good energy your way.
But I have to say, you know, in this past year, I gotta really say, like, the guys at Teen Wolf made a difference for me. I really have to say that. I've been doing 2 and 3 episodes at a time for years and years and years. Mm-hmm. And these guys really, they liked what I was doing. They gave me planned for 2 episodes, and I think I ended up with 11 over 2 seasons, know. And that's nice. That kept me working because I'll tell you what, new pilots and new shows, they look up, and if you're working and people are liking your stuff, they want you all of a sudden, man. And so it's been a great year. Done a lot of work, shot, you know, I have a couple of, like I said, a couple of pilots in the can. They're being shown around town right now. So I'm keeping busy.
Well, congratulations. That's so exciting.
Thanks.
We're excited to see, you know, where your future's going to take you. We will be there watching.
Seriously. Please let us know.
And I'm in a live show. Whenever I get a chance, I do a play, by the way. I'm telling you, actors out there, like, don't stop working. The second you're not doing something, go find something to do.
Yeah.
And I'm doing a version of King Lear.
Can we go and see this?
It's at the Wilgear Theatricum, at the Theatricum Botanicum, which is a beautiful outdoor theater, 300-seat venue in Topanga.
Oh my gosh.
It's in Topanga. It's like a small version of the Greek theater. It's an amazing place to see a show.
Uh-huh.
It's got an awesome slant on it. Instead of a man playing king, Ellen Gear, who is the artistic director of the show, is playing it as a queen. She's made it a story.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
We have
That's
to go see
cool.
that.
It's when
usually,
is it playing?
It's currently playing if you go to theatricum.com. theatricum.com theatricum.com. You can see their schedule.
Okay,
and
awesome.
She is
in, and you're in all the shows.
I'm in that show, and she's like the heavy lifter in the show, and she's amazing.
Wow, I would love
amazing.
To see
amazing. So
let's go.
I'll
okay,
I'll text you both.
Yeah,
and,
awesome.
And
perfect.
So I'm gonna be
and
doing
let's
that
tweet
for the
out
next
the
month.
Details.
Awesome.
Any of the fans who want to come with us, do you and I would love
I
to
would
join
love
us.
Yeah, you know what's hilarious? I just did. I just did a. in the spring, I had a window, so I did a live show. I did 4 weeks of a show called Ajax in Iraq, mm-hmm. down at the Miles Inn.
I wanted to come to that.
A bunch of Teen Wolf fans showed up.
No
Every
way.
Night, people
That's
would come
so
up to
insane.
Me and say, we saw you on Teen Wolf, so we came to see your show.
Wow.
That's fantastic.
And it was just awesome.
I think we talked about it last show.
Yeah, we did.
Just gearing up for it.
So. Actually, we should tweet this picture out that you sent me. Did you tweet
that? Oh, I just sent her a show.
Yeah.
It was
awesome.
A gnarly dark show.
It looks awesome.
It's good.
Well, we have to wrap up. But I can't
wait. Thank you so much
wait.
For having me again.
Thank
such
you
a
so much.
Really
it's always such
coming.
A blast when
know,
you join us
really
in
is.
Studio.
Thank you.
Where can the fans follow you?
You can follow me. I'm at Loudmouth Tarzan. If you want to follow me on Twitter, awesome. That comes from my trapeze days. Or
is there
Aaron
a number
Hendry.
On the end?
No, at okay. Loudmouth Tarzan or yeah. Aaron Hendry IMDb.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. June, where can we find
and
you?
And you guys can always tweet me questions or comments at miss_Junlee. That's M-S, not M-I-S-S.
Awesome. And it looks like next week, Derek's making his own Deadpool list.
Dun, 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 dun,
for everyone dun. That's hunting them. There's a special screening of it on Sunday night before the VMAs. I think at 7 o'clock on MTV, but they're also going to show it on Monday. So our show's going to be on Tuesday. I hope you guys will join us. You can follow me at Cinematic Escape on Twitter, or you can check out my blog, cinematicescape.com. Thanks for tuning in.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Yes, he does.
Buzz you later!
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.
Thank you for watching AfterBuzz TV on YouTube. For more of your favorite after shows and interviews, subscribe to our channel here and be sure to share your opinion on the episode in the comment section below here. We'd love to see what you guys are buzzing about. Thanks again. Buzz you later.